top of the world with Times Network. And you're watching Magic Bricks Now.
Welcome to this very special conversation with Geetamber Anand. Mr. Anand, thank you so much for spending time with us. It's a pleasure to have this chat with you. And I'm especially excited about having this conversation at this point because I know that this is the time when a lot of members of the industry across the country are looking forward to a regulator, some with anticipation, some with a certain level of nervousness, because it's going to change everything about this industry. The way you build, the way we buy, the way, you know, the market is funded and regulated. What is your, you know, biggest concern right now for regulator coming in?
You see, Faye, we've always, from CREDAI, you know, we've always been for a regulator, but in the right spirit. Unfortunately, what's happened is, and you said this on your show also, the sanctioning or the approval authority has been left out of the regulator. The argument that the policymakers give is that the regulator comes in after you've got your approvals. Very well. What happens to my occupancy certificate? What happens to my application for my bijli, pani, sewer connection when my buildings are ready? I cannot give possession to my customer if I don't have electricity or water or even an OC. So at that point in time, a regulator was, you know, a necessity even for the industry. Mm. Who does the industry go to when you apply for an OC or a connection, you know, and you don't get it for 2 months, 3 months, 1 year, 6 months? Who looks into that? Who do we go and complain to? So that, unfortunately, has been left out by the regulator, and this is not in the interest of the customer also.
Do you think perhaps, I know that every state is now writing their rules. Maharashtra is done writing the rules and now just bringing in the regulator. If there's representation made by industry bodies to each state government, might there be some room here to bring in some more jurisdiction over approvals?
Well, it seems highly unlikely. And we will push nonetheless, because otherwise this entire regulator is of, you know, as far as delivery goes and possession goes, it's only addressing one part of the problem and not the other part of the problem, which is, you know, this window of corruption at every level in various parts of the country where whenever you go for a permission, you are asked to pay money. Mm. So unless this is not addressed and this delay is not condoned when the developer goes and asks for a permission, there is no point of having a regulator. So we are going to put this across to various governments, and I must say today people are willing to listen. Politicians are willing to listen, because you see, it's a concern now. If we raise our voice tomorrow as an industry body and say this is wrong and we are not to blame for it, I'm sure you will give us a hearing on your show, and you will convey this to the people who are supposed to do it right, the politicians.
Actually, there are two different problems here. One, of course, is the problem of corruption, which I think should be addressed in absolute immediacy, because if we don't, then we might have a regulator, which is another window that needs, you know, that needs worrying about. How important is it, and I want to take this step by step, how important is it to carefully pick the bureaucrats or the people who will be manning the offices of these regulators? There'll be at least one in every city or one in every state.
It's an extremely good point you've raised, because we fear that these chairs will be sold eventually to maybe undeserving people. So it has to be seen by various states that this position is not misused to, like you said, to create another window of corruption. It is to be seen whether that will happen or not, but the bill per se tries to eliminate human interaction by saying that this will be done online in a fixed time of 30 days. But after saying that, there are provisions in the bill which say that after that the papers will be scrutinized and they'll keep scrutinizing them.
There is room for discretion given to the person sitting at
there is room,
which is a problem right now with local level permissions.
Absolutely.
As well.
In fact, a very, very big concern of CREDAI was that, you know, there's a clause for cancellation. Mm. Now, cancellation can be done by the regulator. if he feels that the facts have been misrepresented, and there is a whole host of facts which can qualify as misrepresentation. So imagine this, Faye, a project which is nearly 80-90% complete. The person sitting on that chair, for whatever reason, even for malafide interest, feels that, you know, I am going to issue a cancellation notice, or I'm going to cancel this project. That project is 80% complete, maybe 100% sold, and then you get this cancellation notice or this show cause notice, or maybe even a cancellation order post a show cause notice, and the project comes to a standstill. Who all suffer? I mean, the businessman suffers, the developer suffers, but the customers also suffer.
Well, the other side of the new regulator will be the appellate tribunals that will come in, which are fundamentally, for the benefit of our audience, courts that will decide only on cases between developers and customers, with a 90-day deadline, which is also, you know, slightly scary. Now, staffing these benches is going to be a challenge across all of our states. How sensitive is this issue, and how careful do we need to be?
Well, extremely sensitive, and for the same reasons that I mentioned just now. And you see, Faye, what is going to happen is, if this regulator doesn't work properly, what is going to happen is that your supply will be cut short, because not many people will do this as a business then, because there's so much of risk involved, there's so much of uncertainty involved, there's so much of blackmail that can happen to the businessman here, that not many people will do it. And the people who are doing it will actually cut down, because it says if you have an occupancy certificate, then you needn't register with the regulator. So the intent will be, why should I get into this? Let me just make a building, borrow money, or do that.
You know, I've heard several developers say this to me, saying that I will only build 10% of what I'm building right now. I will wait until it's completely ready before I sell it. But at the end of the day, you're all running businesses. You have employees who need to be paid. You have an ecosystem that has to be sustained.
Yeah.
Is that a practical solution?
No, it's not a practical solution, but not many people will be doing this business. Maybe if I'm doing, 5,000 units a year, maybe I continue doing those 5,000, but people who are doing 500 units a year will stop doing this business, because there's too much at risk. And
so you have 11,000 members of,
yes,
of CREDAI.
Yes.
There's a long tail. I mean, there's about 20% large nationally loaned name, but there's a long tail to tier 2, tier 3 local,
yes,
developers.
Yes.
Are you saying you'll see consolidation, and a lot of that long tail will leave the business?
They're already talking about it, Faye. And they're saying, you know, we have projects which are going on. Let's finish them before the regulator comes, and then do something else. Maybe just aggregate land and give it to people who want to develop. So the risk of development is going to increase, the challenges of development are going to be huge, and you'll have these chosen few who will dare to...
But the chosen few, like you yourself, operate,
yeah,
in certain markets in North India,
yeah,
not all of them. Who's going to build in the smaller markets?
That's why I said you'll see a cutting short of supply, which will obviously lead to an increase in sale prices. So once supply is restrained and constrained, you will see that prices will go up, because there's that much less stock in the market. What you see today, what has happened? Why has there been a rationalization of prices? Because there's been a flood of supply in most markets. It's come before its time. There is a demand. There's a documented shortage of housing in this country, 2 crore houses. But these were to be absorbed maybe in the next 5 years. They came in suddenly in the last 5 years, and now we're seeing, you know, most of them close to possession maybe in the next 2 years. So the buyer is spoiled for choice, and it's a good market for the buyer. It's a buyer's market, and he's getting a great price and a great deal. But once this stock is, you know, exhausted and it's taken up and it's sold, fresh supply is going to be very, very, very limited, and that is when you'll see a rise in prices. Good locations are already gone. Land, you know, it's not going to be manufactured again. So what land there was has been built on. And it'll be sold in the next 2 years and consumed. The new locations won't probably be so attractive, but whatever stock comes up will be priced definitely.
So if
higher.
You were asking whether the prices of real estate are going to recover, it's going to be something that's actually precipitated by the regulator, you think?
Not really. The regulator will discourage a lot of developers from doing this business. It will not be an immediate result of the regulator, but yes, there will be a big role of the regulator to drive the price.
You completely squeeze the pipe of supply.
Absolutely.
Then
it's the law of business. Right. The more the supply, the lesser the price. The lesser the supply, the more the price.
Let's talk about the NCR market particularly. In our experience of dealing with local government in the NCR market, we found that the multiplicity of authority is constantly coming in the way of work. We found that you have three state governments, you have local authorities. Within the city of Delhi, there are three municipal corporations who don't see eye to eye with the state government. State government doesn't see eye to eye with the LG or the center. There's a lot of back and forth and a lot of very, very important work slips through the cracks of the national capital. When the regulator comes in, will we also again have three regulators deciding on three different zones, not seeing eye to eye with each other? So someone like yourself, who's also building in Gurgaon and building in Noida, is going to have to deal with completely different people?
See, this is what the first assumption is, that this is what the situation will be. But what is the work of our association? So from our association, we are going to various state governments, to various chief ministers of various state governments, and telling them all to have something like a uniform set of rules for the regulator, so that for people who are working in multiple locations and states, this doesn't become a challenge. Very rightly said, it could very well become a huge challenge. Having said that, I must say that whoever we've met understand that this industry needs to be sustained. Housing is a requirement. Housing for all is the slogan of the government, and housing is an immediate requirement of the Indian people. So most chief ministers also understand that housing will drive the GDP of the state. It'll create more jobs, it'll push manufacturing, it'll push up GDP. So they are empathizing with our concerns.
Enough to bring approvals in under the purview of the regulator?
They understand it, and they have, some chief ministers said, you're right. So what we can do is, we can get, you know, if when we frame the laws, we can get in the municipal bodies or the urban local bodies only for issuing plinth certificates and completion certificates and maybe sewer and electricity and water connections. Yes. So we have got that first, you know, ray of hope from them, that they are talking of that in the framing of the rules and the laws, they can in some way make the ULB answerable for delays in giving permissions of a nearly complete project.
I also want to talk to you about prices. There's enough being said in the market. On one hand, I mean, this is, I think, the third or the fourth time the RBI governor has said that, you know, real estate companies have to relook at prices. On the other hand, I know you are saying that banks need to relook at their interest rates, which have technically not passed on all of the cuts that the governor has given us. It seems like you're waiting for each to blink first. It doesn't seem like either is going to blink right now.
We blinked long ago. I mean, industry has blinked. You see, it's documented. There's been a price correction, at least 15% to 20% across the country in the last year and a half. And there's no further room for, you know, what will happen is, and I respect what the RBI governor has observed, but this may be true for maybe two or three markets, maybe in the metros, maybe two or three metros. But if you have to look at the situation in a very holistic fashion. We are a large country and homes are required across the country. Prices are moving in a band of 3,500 rupees a square foot, or maybe 3,000 rupees a square foot, to 5,000, 5,500 rupees a square foot in most cities. Only in some metros they are above that. Now, in that price band, there's land cost, there's construction cost. So wherever the land cost is less, you'll see a price of between 3 and 3,500 rupees in locations like maybe even in Punjab, maybe in somewhere down south, sure. You know, so it's across, and wherever, as the land becomes expensive, the price will move up, like in Bangalore, 5,500. You get a lot of apartments.
Tell me this, is there a view that developers are making a lot more money than they're really making, whether it's from the government, whether it's from local corporators, whether it's from the banks? It's just a view that your margins are a lot thicker than they really are.
Well, it's, you know, the thing is, they were at one point in time. But that's not true any longer, because, you know.
So I'm thinking perception.
Perception is wrong.
What is this industry doing wrong that everybody seems to think that, A, there's a lot of money to be had from this industry, and everybody seems to be viewing real estate developers as the big bad wolf?
The big bad wolf, you're right, they view us as the big bad wolf, but, you know, they also think that there's a lot of money being made here. It's like any manufacturing industry now. So it's if you do high turnover, low margin, why does a person do business? He does business to make money. to make profit. He does business for profit, and profit is not a bad word. But if you make profit by immoral means and by the wrong, you know, with wrong intent, we are totally against it, you know, as a body, and we condemn it. But this conception, misconception and perception that real estate has got huge margins is not true for most of the country. It may be true in Mumbai and maybe in some locations in Delhi, but it's not true otherwise as a general rule. Taxation is so high, 30% of the entire sale price is taxes. And there's Provident Fund, ESI, VAT, excise. I mean, you name it, we have all the taxes for us. So a lot of that sale price goes into taxes. So, you know, for a new developer, it might, you know, on back of the envelope calculation would show a decent profit. But when you come down to actually constructing and executing your project, you realize, man, I was wrong. You know, it's not so attractive because the construction costs are going up, labor costs are going up. So it's not like that.
You know, the other big thing that's happened in the last 1 week is the Delhi High Court actually turning around and saying, why are you charging service tax on under construction property, which I'm hoping everybody's turning around and realizing it's a perfectly commonsensical question to ask. But do you see, do you foresee the government taking a cue from this and actually questioning why we are paying service tax on under construction property?
So when this came in 2010, 1st June 2000, when this actually, the government came up with this act that under construction property will attract tax, CREDAI Karnataka went to Karnataka High Court and said this is not, it is not constitutionally correct. Why? On one hand, you qualify real estate as an immovable asset and you charge a stamp duty. Yes. On the other hand, you qualify it as a service and you're charging a service tax. So if you're charging one, you cannot charge the other. It's as simple as that. Either you charge a stamp duty and quantify and qualify it as an immovable asset, or you consider it as a service and you charge service tax, then no stamp duty. It was struck down by the High Court, totally. Today, on the same ground, well, it's what the court has said is that the tax per se is not wrong, but the method of calculation is wrong. So the government must come up with a, you know, credible method of calculation to charge this tax.
Even if it comes down marginally from what it is today, which is fairly high for someone who's buying under construction because they cannot afford to buy what is ready to occupy.
Look at the irony.
A customer would not want to buy something ready to occupy.
A customer who's wealthy can buy a ready-to-move-in property, maybe a little more expensive, but a customer who wants to take advantage of a launch price has to pay service tax because he cannot afford to buy a property which is, you know, ready and does not attract service tax. That is the irony of the situation. We are talking about affordable housing and housing for all here. But yes, it must be struck down. This has to be re-looked at by the government. But it's, you see, it's not going to be easy for the government to give up service tax. A bigger worry, a bigger concern for industry.
Can they use GST as an option to rationalize?
I was coming to that. So once GST kicks in, this will be absorbed in that. Now GST is going to be a bigger devil for real estate than this. Why?
Because now you're a goods and a service tax.
Yes. So then there's going to be a stamp duty and there's going to be a GST. So if GST is fixed at 16 or 18% and there's a stamp duty at 5%, my customer will have to pay a 23% over and above price. So that's ridiculous. So this, again, we have been requesting government to look at this particular aspect of real estate and subsume the stamp duty in the GST for real estate. And I hope they see some reason in this and do something about it.
I hope so too. We also need to talk about delays, especially since we are in the NCR region. There are numbers that show us that a two-year delay at this point is almost par for the course. We've been telling our viewers that 1 year delay you should just expect, because it's a tough market at this point. Yes. A lot of times permissions delay even the best developer.
Yes.
In several cases. But I want to understand from inside of CREDAI right now, what are you doing? How are you helping your members? And it's true, the industry needs help. How are you helping your members overcome this massive hurdle and sort of find ways to deliver to their customers?
So where, you see, most of our members have not delayed exponentially. There are delays because Noida is a very peculiar market. There were land issues, there were NGT issues, but you
that
know,
whole Okhla Bird Sanctuary problem delayed
unexpected,
a lot of projects.
You know, yeah, it was very unexpected because projects were going on, and then so over here, what we are trying to tell, see, the problem, Faye, is organizational discipline. One, unforeseen circumstances too, and execution. You know, the capability to execute and to find a good contractor who can execute. Now, there, believe it or not, a lot of developers are actually not finding good contractors to construct. And if they do find them, the contractor also, you know, time and again asks for escalation in prices, mm-hmm. I'll stop the work, and things like that.
Did the NCR market grow faster than the developers could actually keep up with?
Yes.
Did this market launch projects without fully being prepared for the back end of how am I going to finish? Is the fiscal discipline in order to, you know, make sure that we deliver?
So you're right. What happened was that when after the depression of 2008-09, when Noida saw some new land allotments, people who were not into real estate got into real estate, thinking that, you know, the market is good and it's going to get better, so let's start doing real estate. They didn't have a background of construction or real estate, and you know, from other businesses, people from totally diverse
unrelated
businesses came into real estate. The entire calculation of the business profit or the sense of that real estate business was all based on hearsay and nothing on professional advice. That is why they launched projects which are well below price, you know, below doable prices, extremely cheap per square foot rates were so low, and we were always, you know,
there were investors coming in and doing bulk deals on projects
also, yes.
And then they never came back to pay their second
hand government. See, that's true too, but what really, let me tell you what happened. So people were launching projects at 2000 rupees a square foot. 2000 rupees a square foot is the construction cost, maybe more. So how would they pay for the land? What money would they make? But it was like there was a competition because everybody had come into the market at the same time, and everybody was launching at the same time. So there was cutthroat competition. It was all, you know, telling on the price. And the NCR at in 2010, Noida Extension, if we talk about Noida Extension, was selling prices, selling apartments at you know, sub 2000 rupees. How can you complete a project at that price? It's impossible. So when they actually got into the entire process of execution, they realized that they'd made a huge mistake. And how would they complete the project? So then came in the attraction of more FSI. So the only way to complete this was to buy some more FSI. So when more FSI would come in, the NOC from the customer was required. A lot of customers said yes, a lot of them said no. There was a tussle between them, so that too caused some delay. But the only way that they project could be delivered and completed was that this chap who's undersold his stock would get some more FSI and actually sell it at a higher price and cross-subsidize the two and complete the project. So that is what is happening today. All the projects that were delayed are now seeing completion with that new FSI which people had bought. So our advice to our members was, you know, focus on financial discipline, focus on execution, and also be transparent and let your customer have access to you.
How are you dealing with complaints that are coming to your consumer grievance cell? I know you do have one very, very active cell right now in the NCR region.
So I think in the last year, and I must compliment the president of CREDAI NCR, Manoj Gaur, he's actually resolved more than over 1,500 cases. Mm. What we do is, what can we do? We are not a judicial body, you know. We don't have any judicial powers, so to speak. So what can we do? We can put peer pressure. So when And also the advantage of being a CREDAI member today is seen very distinctly by members, and they don't want to lose it. So we can only threaten them, you know, you lose your membership if you don't listen, if you don't stick to the decision of the redressal cell. Because the developer has all the right to say that I don't accept your decision, you're wrong, I'll go to a court of law, let my customer go to a court of law. So what we said in the NCR was that if a customer does not listen to or does not adhere to the decision of the grievance cell, then he will lose his membership. So that went down very well with the members. And most of them, you know, that is why the NCR cell of CREDAI was able to resolve a lot of disputes. And most of the disputes were a lack of communication.
You still have a few members, I could give you names, with complaints against them from large groups of
yes.
customers.
Yes.
There's a need perhaps here to take a stronger stand in just maybe helping them fix the back end of the problem, helping them find the contractor, helping him fix the fiscal problem. Is that something that, you know, as an industry senior, you're getting into, you're advising people on?
Yes, absolutely. And all the seniors over here are advising people. But then that developer should be willing to listen. If he says, you know, who are you to tell me what to do and how to do it, then we just step back and say, okay, then you lose your membership, you're no longer a member of the organization. Because, like I said, we're not a judicial body, you know, we can't issue a judgment against him and say, okay, from tomorrow, you can't do this real estate business, or you are going to be put behind bars or something like that.
We can only do what's
we can only put
your
pressure and, you know, explain to him, look, you're making a wrong move here. So why don't you let us advise you to set things right for yourself? So most of them do listen, but some of them still don't listen. So then,
you know, in a market like this, especially in the NCR region, you've still managed to gather some very, very happy customers and some very happy investors who you've given exits to at very, very good returns. I know Khushru Jijina calls you an alpha. He's forbidden me from borrowing that term, but I'm going to. Tell us, and for all of the, you know, members of the industry who are listening right now, tell us what you're doing different. And tell us what people can learn from that.
Nothing different, really. You know, we maintain very high financial discipline. Mm-hmm. So mostly all our projects are in different SPVs. And there is no way that we can take money out from one project and take it to another one. And as a rule, you know, I mean, it may be expensive for us. We do have some financial institution in each project. So the accounts are escrowed and they are monitored. And construction and execution is senior to everything else. Mm-hmm. So once you deliver FE, you have happy customers, happy investors, happy everything, you know, happy banks. So that's the only mantra. Financial discipline, and also our other strength is execution. You know, we don't outsource construction. So we, in the company, within the company, we have about 4,000 employees on roll who actually oversee our construction, and we do our own construction. So that saves a lot of time for us. You know, there's no disagreement between the contractor and the developer. You know, I'm asking you to change a little bit of the project. He said no, this was not part of the contract. So all that is eradicated. It's just one. You you have to complete the project this much time, and that's what you do.
I also want you to give advice right now to everyone who's listening, because like we started this conversation with, when a regulator comes in, things are going to change. All things will be equal. Do you believe that in that market then, customer service, execution, you know, fiscal responsibility, you have to be ready for 70% escrow. We have a year, perhaps, within which this industry is going to have to prepare for these changes.
So actually, the advice that the association has given all members is to start adopting a lot of the requirements of the regulator. Start declaring area as the regulator would have you declare it. Start maintaining financial discipline. Start maintaining your documents the way the regulator wants you to present them. So we are already in the process of educating most members what is to be done once the regulator comes in. We are already telling most members to start having agreements in the same tone and tenor as the requirement of the regulator, to charge as much interest as you would be giving them in case of a penalty, to start reading the entire bill, the act, to understand what is in store for us in coming years. So, and people, I must say,
you're telling me there are members of the industry who have not read the act yet.
A lot of people don't like to read, let me put it that way. They'd rather sit down and listen to
the lawyer, perhaps.
they do that.
No, so you said also, since you said that in the NCR over the last couple of years, there were people who had nothing to do with this market who got into real estate. Is it also perhaps the time for some developers to introspect and say, do I want to stay? Do I want to JD? Do I want to find a stronger partner who will take up these?
It's already happening. It's happening. And a lot of developers now who don't want to do execution are looking for developers who know how to build and deliver. So that JD model has already come in, and it's already happening. So if a brand is strong in the market, if a brand sells in the market, and there's a developer who has land but he doesn't, you know, have a brand and he doesn't have the capacity to execute, he's actually shaking hands with the person who can, and they're making a go of the entire project. So it's happening already. It's happening. Consolidation in some form has started.
For final question for the end user home buyer. who's been waiting right now, whether sitting on the fence or not sitting on the fence, waiting to see how this plays out. Because there was a general view that the prices will come down further. That view I've watched evaporate from the market in the last couple of quarters across the board. Nobody believes that's happening anymore. What is your advice to someone who's looking to buy a home to live in with their families?
So I would say this is the best time to buy because considering that we are looking at a good monsoon coming up, I think the market will move. So when you are going out to buy, identify a developer, see what he's done in the past, see his delivery record, see his track record, and ask a few people who bought in with the developer whether he's accessible, he's transparent, whether he listens to complaints or not. And if all these are a tick, then go and close that deal now, because maybe you don't get that deal 3 months down the line. So this is the best time to go and buy that house. That's what I would say.
All right, this is the best time to buy. And of course, the advice is to be as picky about your developer as ever.
Yes, because of course.
That's the most important
decision.
All right, Mr. Anand, thank you so much for your time. It's been
a
pleasure to
chat. Lovely. Thank you so much.